Well, welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. We've come down to a lake down near Weymouth. I'm fishing with Mackie from the Weymouth Angling Centre. It's a lake he fishes. In fact, there's two lakes here. We've got carp in there. Quite a decent sized carp. Good, apparently a good chance of a double figure carp. And very big bream. So, breams are double figures. I've not even seen, so I don't know. But that'd be a bonus. If I could get a double figure bream, would be nice. I expect it won't. They're giving a cold spell coming in, like starting the temperature drop tomorrow, so we're just on the back edge of what we call a very mild spell, early winter. You've got to give it a go, haven't you guys? You've got to give it a go. So Mackie and I are in two different swims. The lake here is a central small lily bed, and we're fishing out towards that. Put some bait out there. I'm using ground bait with pellets because I've still got the outside idea and notion that there might be a bream with my name on it out there. Probably doubtful. But if Mackie does get a carp or I get a carp, I might have to switch over to boilies. We're on boilies basically, but I just figure feeder and 4mm pellet. I think it might be an 8mm pellet. I've got 4s in the feeder and an 8 on the hook bait. It's a banded pellet. See what we can do. It's a lovely little spot here, I have to say. It's not monstrous lakes. The other lake over there is much bigger, but this one apparently has a good chance of catching fish in it. Lovely rushes around there, lovely hillsides set right down in a valley. So even though it's blowing a pretty cold easterly, that easterly might actually knock it on the head for us. It's got several swims, you can fish pretty well all the way around it. And they've got some of these, they're like barges, they're like a floating barge, which I assume they make platforms on, because a lot of guys don't like fishing off them. So I think I'll have a go off one, and this is how I've set up. Well, you can see these mooring barges or platforms they've got here. And I guess that's for fishing off. A lovely, stable, flat platforms. Obviously, you need to have those rod pod things, you know, that you put your rod pods in. And obviously, that needs clearing, doesn't it, if you're fishing off of there. But nevertheless, some lovely, you can see it up there. I put the camera up high so you can take a look at it. Lovely spot, very, very sheltered. We're fishing over near that central lily pads. I'd almost fancy long-range float fishing. There's fish moving all over there. In there, I can see fish moving where I put some bait. But, you know, are they carp? Are they bream? I don't know. Certainly, for sure, there's fish there. I'm not sure whether to even try float fishing for them, but they're definitely feeding on something. It's pretty shallow, beautiful rushes here. Look, these reeds, I call them reeds or rushes. Are they the same thing? Somebody tell me. Goes down into a bay around the back of an island there. There's the pontoons. Mackie's just over around there on a... Wow, that one spooked. So that definitely was a fish. So we might actually be in with a chance, guys, of seeing something. I'll show you my setup around here. Look at the hillside all around here. Beautiful. Can imagine this in the spring and the summer. Be absolutely a sun trap. Just a day ticket water. £10 a day is all we've done. I think I'd do a 24-hour ticket as well. So these are the pontoons. As you can see there, that's my priority bait there. Yes, cinnamon swirls. I've tried some floaters, dog biscuits out there, nothing. I've got all my junk and camera and clobbers there. So what I've done here for the backrest, I've managed to tie it onto the pontoon, one of those rings, jam it in there. This one, I've got balanced through there. There's my bobbin, Mike's bobbin. This one's obviously my bobbin. See it there? A critically balanced cut down. You've got to laugh at that critically balanced old twaddle, haven't you? It's a critically balanced cut down washing up bottle top. Critically, but has to be critically balanced. I'm critically balanced on this pontoon. This one doesn't have a bait run attachment to it because I've been pike fishing with it yesterday with Mackie. So I've backed the drag off so it can pull line, and I'm on back wind as well there. Well, we used to fish old school like that. Pellets. Boilies, haven't got hardly any boilies left. Ground bait's here, which I've got to damp down again a little bit further. A little bit, yes, it's just about dried out a bit, so don't be afraid to damp your pellets down, you know, or damp your ground bait down if it goes. Don't over damp it. Make sure it stays in the feeder, but you want it to come out of the feeder. So feeder is to the right of the lilies by about 6-8 feet. The boilie is to the left, as tight as I can get. And Mackie's over there through the rushes. He's fishing out pretty well. We can see that he's baited because you can see the birds around there. You can see the moorhens diving. I think they're eating all my boilies as well. Fish, you know, they are moving across there. There's one or two movements there, but not going to get a lot on the surface, I guess, because obviously it's very cold. it's not the summer. Water's clear, very, very shallow here. I have indeed thrown a ball of ground bait down there just in case any small stuff comes over it, but I don't think it's a margin fishing one. I think it is fishing it away here. Although when I walked around by these rushes, I saw fish moving just in front of the rushes there as well. It seems like there's weed over there. I've definitely got fish out there. So I'm going to damp up the ground bait, give it 10 to 12, get to 12, and I'll put a few more balls of that and see if we can't spark one up. This reel, because I was obviously pike fishing with it, doesn't have the bait runner attachment, so I've got the drag light and I've got the backwind on there. Now let's go and see Mackie. Hang on, what was that? What was that? Boys, I don't know what to say. Oh, I'm on pellet. I'm going to try and ease this one in. Oh my God, he's on the other side of the lake. I don't know if you're going to see anything here, people. It's a carp light on the other side of the lake. Oh man, we've got this fishing, I'll be lucky. He goes left for those lilies, I'm in trouble. Wow, whack-a-diddly-doo. I thought these were bream. I just need him to plane to the right a bit. Got fish on, Mackie? Yeah. I saw the swirl. I'm hoping he's going to keep going right. Oh, if he does, I might have a chance of getting him. Got quite a bit of weed on the line. Not a bream, but the problem I've got is the feeder slid right up the line. I'm hoping he doesn't go in the rushes. He needs to turn. He's come off. Looks like the hook's pulled there. That's a shame. That was on the pellet. Well. Got him in. Close in there. Yeah, got the hook and everything, guys. That was on pellet and a feeder. That was on pellet and a feeder and a hook pulled. That's round one to the fish. Mackie's fishing around here. As you can see from this angle, he's about where those birds are, just over to the left. So what's your setup, Mackie?
I've just got sort of two pound test curve rods. You don't need anything too heavy, nice and light. Just a couple of Mitchell bait runners, loaded with 12 pound line. That's pretty much my setup. As to the end of the rig, I'm using PVA bags. I'm using a little Fox rapid load system.
Yeah.
So what you do is you put your PVA bag, so you squeeze.
These are solid bags you're talking about?
Yeah, solid PVA bag. So you squeeze this in and you put your tool on. And then you put your
bag, my tool on?
Yeah.
You're basically, that's too small for me.
So you put your PVA bag, solid bag on there. And when you pull that off, it tightens up and opens the bag.
Yes.
You put a few pellets in, you drop your rig in, you can scoop whatever you want in, and then you twist it, and then the PVA is still around here, and you lick this bit, and then you push your bag up through, and it seals it all down.
Oh, really?
And all I'm using is some pellets. I've got some boilers I've crushed up in there, so a real mix-up, and some other corn twist bait smoke.
And you tip off with fake corn or something?
I'm just using bits of fake corn. So what I've done is I've just chopped one of these in half.
Yep.
And using half of one on a balanced wafter, which is the manila wafter there from Sticky. Really, really nice. Really good winter bait because they're quite a sweet bait.
So tell people what a wafter is. Now, it's not a boilie, and it's not a pop-up. No. It's halfway,
it's
isn't it?
Sort of a balance, really. Yeah. It's a balanced, they call them a balanced wafter. They sort of sit, they don't pop up, they don't sit on the bottom, they just sit like a neutral sort of buoyancy, and they just waft around. and it's perfect for fishing, obviously, if you're over weed or anything, because it'll always rest on top, and it's a really light bait, so as soon as a fish takes it, it will go flying up there. So as soon as the carp suck it up, it's pretty much straight in and
they've hooked.
Hooked straight away.
What's those? I see. Looking at those rod rest things here. Look at that folding bit on. I've not seen those.
Oh, it's just it sticks in better. So it's got a little two spikes there. And
so what is that for? You push on it.
It's just stability really.
Oh, I see. Yes, yeah.
So I'm just using a couple of little rubber grips at the end to keep it in.
Yeah.
I've got a rod pod, but recently I've started using just the single bank sticks. It's, you can space your rods out a lot easier.
Yeah.
And if you hook a fish, there's no messing around. You're sort of able to sort of not have to like hop over the pod here and there. You can just free roam.
And you
wherever.
Can you can cast one rod to the left, one left, one to the right. You know,
and you can have your line pointing directly
straight
to the
rods
as well. Your line pretty much points directly to the rigs. You don't have to worry about where they're going. It works really well.
What about line? What line are you on there?
So it's just 12-pound Daiwa sensor. As you can see, I've been using a bit of red tape, but I've now got a bit of bait floss. So I've used a bit of bait floss, tied it on, like a little stop knot.
Yeah.
So I can use that as a marker for where I can clip up. So I want to fish as tight to the lily pads as I can.
And that's your red tape that you'd use, some electrical tape?
Yeah, I use the red tape, but it keeps sliding a little. So yeah. I've just used a bit of bait cotton. So I suppose you could use a little bit of anything, really.
Yeah.
A bit of brightly coloured lines just to tie on there.
Well, we're both pretty well set up now. The wind's coming and going. It's an easterly, so it's not great for fishing. But I can see little dimples and small fins moving, but big fish, if that makes sense. There's a beep on there now. I think I'm getting liners there. But you know what? It's weird. I'm getting all the liners I'm getting. I can see a fish moving there. They are on pellets. So who knows? Small baits might be the way to go. So I've gone back to a pop-up on this one. Look, I'm no great carp fisherman. If we catch it, we catch. If we don't, we don't. It won't keep me awake at night. I'm not going to have a brain seizure from contemplating all the different rigs I could be fishing or baits. One tip for the winter for cold water I do know, and it does work, and that's red maggots. Bunches and bunches of red maggots. And red maggots, you know, in a bag, get them out there. They work really well, apparently. I've not used them a great deal, only close in on margin fishing, but they do tell me if you concentrate quite a lot of maggots, then they go crackers on them certain times of year. I think it's more January, February time that they, you know, December, January, February, the height of the winter. Now I don't know why that is, because why do they not take boilies? And it might be cold, they go on the feed. Why do they feed on the maggots? Is it because it's live? It's meat, it's something different, I don't know, but they assure me it works. So we're just sitting here. I've seen nothing move on the surface. I have put some biscuits out. I will put a few more out there, I think, just to catapult some out. Makes it lighter going back up that hill. I haven't got so much to carry. And I've got some of Mike's leftover dog meat. Not that he lives on dog meat. I think his wife feeds him better than that. But Jax has a set of these meat ones based that he doesn't really like. So they're peeled open seal ones. So I'm going to catapult those out as well. So basically anything out there to try and get them on the feed. It seems to me they might be on small baits. I don't know whether to go to pellet on both of them. It's always a bit risky. What I might do is, if I get the bigger camera, if I can hold it, I don't have the tripod, I will try and see if I can't get you a shot of where these fish keep moving, because it gives you guys an idea what it looks like. You might think it's nothing, you might think it's a leaf just drifting on the surface, but it's not. It is a fish's fin, and I might be able to pick that up, little ripples where they're tipping on their tails, I guess, and feeding. So they're going to get another pounding of ground bait in a little while. No real movements. I've seen a few fish move here. I wonder if they've eaten all that bait. So I think I might. I've done another bit of a mix up down here. Got a bit of a mix up with some extra bait in there. Going to peel this one open. Chef's choice, eh? Turkey, game, and veg. Well, whatever it is, Mike's Jack Russell does not like it. However, I do. It's free, and I've caught fish on this stuff before. So we'll cut it into probably cubes, like this, and then hopefully I can catapult it. Now if you do the catapult quite a lot, you'll find that it's much easier if all the bits are the same size. But of course it's quite difficult doing all that, getting it all out, getting them all the same size. And they cast more accurately. Oh, you need smell-o-vision for this stuff. You can almost eat that in a sandwich, you know. I've actually got as well, I've got some of those dog biscuits soaking, because that'll make them a little bit heavier. Not so much softer, which I do normally fish with them soft, but it just will make them a little bit heavier for casting. I might be able to get them a bit further. These ones are disc-shaped, so they go off a bit like a sideways firework. They can go anywhere. They're not particularly accurate for casting. Fine for margin fishing, you know, down here, just scattering out loose. But when you catapult them, they're off like a firework. Right. Let's get... Maybe this is what they say. It's done up like a dog's dinner. That's where the saying comes from. But nice cubes, excellent for margin fishing. And it's got peas in it, and peas are very, very good. I have caught very well on peas. I remember catching, I think it was 16 carp once in one afternoon. Peas, and peas for those guys, if you tip them with brandlings, just tip a piece of a single pea with a little brandling, that seemed pretty deadly. Let's get this catapulted out and see where it goes to. I've no idea what distance it's going to make. It might not even get there. It might explode in the air. Oh no, it goes okay. It's got to be in the water, because anything that's going to increase your chance of a pickup is worth using. Also, these, if you do luncheon meat, if you put in a light dusting of flour or dry fine ground bait, you'll find that when it hits the water, it leaves a little cloud with it as well, which is obviously something that will attract fish as well. Now, I won't be able to use this as hook bait because it's soft, but it's still worth putting in the water. I think I'm going to put a few balls of ground bait out. What I do is I make small, quite firm balls of ground bait, and they're sort of about the same size as I'd be used when I put the mesh bag over here on the boilies. Just like to keep them about the same size. And again, same size is good for accuracy with a catapult. But I feel they are out there, the carp, really sort of only looking for one fish. One fish would be nice, especially if it's a double figure fish. But it's just trying to work out what they're actually feeding on in cold weather in the winter. So squeezing that quite tight to allow for the breakdown in the water. It's a bit like sort of putting 10 bags out, isn't it? Like 10 bags or 10 of those mesh bags to put the feed in the water. This is doing the same thing. It's about the same size. And you'll be fishing till 4:30, so I feel I ought to just pound them a little bit, get them feed, and see if I can't pull one fish out of the bag. Really nice to have that fish I lost. Right, so we're getting on later in the afternoon. I'm going to put a bag back out. I'm going to put some pellets in first, and then I've cut up some 18mm boilies. I've dropped those in as well. It's a PVA mesh bag I use. Shake that down, pinch more pellets. I'll put some more ground bait out there. It's getting near 2:45, 3:45. I've got about 2 hours, I would think we got. I'm going to try and, as you can see, pack all that down. Make sure you do it with dry hands, not wet hands. So I'll tie this down. Now, I've got left of my scissors down there, so I'm going to try and cut this bag. That's cut. Make sure you put these away. Keep them dry. Put the lid on. Two or three turns. So the bag's there. The lid's on its slider there. I'm going to wang it out, hopefully. Oh, that ground bait's gone. If I can get it untangled. Why am I tangled? You guys get this? You ought to get a tangle around the tip. very, very easy to have a crack off. And I'm going to change of rig, I think he's done there. Right guys, get me larger net. I had a shout from Mackie. At long last, a hookup. It's been a long time coming. He's not in yet. You right with the other rod there?
Yeah.
Oh, you're way up there. Got him. I can see him. Yeah, yeah. Up on the surface too.
He took me right into the reed, so I had to literally like...
Hang on.
Yeah, he took me into the lily pad, so I had to like give him a good scrap through. But he didn't look too bad.
It's what you call them. It's a bonefish, Mackie. It's not a carp, it's a 10-pound bonefish.
There we go. Well done. All the way to the net.
He was a scrapper for sure, that one.
I think they're on the old single pop-ups.
Yeah, that's a good double, isn't it?
Straight onto the mat.
Let's get him moistened.
And what flavour was that on, Mackie?
It's like a fruity pink pop-up. I thought, obviously, nothing's really working, so...
You've got to change them, you've got to keep changing. That is the trick.
Perfect, look at that.
Yeah, just in the corner there, yeah.
Barbless hook as well, that one. So let's get the rig out of the way before we do anything. No accidents.
You wish you hadn't done that, didn't you? That mud.
So here we have a typical fish run out of this lake.
Ooh. Are they going here to what? What
20.
Yeah, up to 20s, yeah.
But yeah, no. This is just your classic sort of wallies. Carp.
That's a good one.
Easily a double.
Oh yeah, it's about 12s.
Yeah, 12, 13.
Yeah, probably might go 13, so, that one. A big tail on him.
Yeah,
big, nice fresh tail.
Good condition fish. I mean, obviously he's been in here years. He's seen the bank a few times. He's got a few
little nicks in there, yeah.
Yeah, but gorgeous fish. So
success in every pack.
Yeah, we'll get him back in and hopefully go and get a couple more.
Well, one or two. At least we succeeded there. Hey? Cold war carping.
Spot on. go.
Yeah, I've got him.
Away he goes. This is the Fox Rapid Load system. So basically what it is it's a really quick way to get your PVA bags ready and cast out. So what you want to do is you squeeze the plastic and you put this, like, it sort of keeps it all in check. So once that's on, like that, you then grab your PVA bags. So get your PVA bag, open him up. Once you've opened it up, yeah, pop your loader into the PVA bag, solid bag.
And they come in different sizes, don't they?
Yeah, this is the small size which I'm using, but you can get the bigger size. So once it's on, you pull this black thing off and it expands, so yeah, it keeps it secure. Yeah. And then you just slide your bag up slightly. Make sure it's all nice and sort of on like that, and then what you do is scoop a little bit in there to start off with, and then you basically get your rig and you drop it in the bag like that, and then fill it up with a few more pellets. Tap it down like that, and then you twist slightly like that, and then this is the bit you lick the PVA all around the edges, and then you just wiggle it onto the bag like that, and then that will come off, and what you're left with is PVA bag.
Nice, neat job.
Yeah, just, you can neaten it up a bit by just wetting these corners and folding them in.
Makes it a bit more aerodynamic, does it?
Yeah, it makes it so it's casts better, and then just give that a little push down. And then what I like to do is slightly open the bag and put this PVA friendly goo in there. So fill that up.
And doesn't dissolve the bag then?
No, it's PVA friendly. I mean, there is a little split at the bottom there, sure, but nothing's really going to come out of it. Basically got my, it was all clipped up, so that's all ready now, so when I next cast in I know exactly where to go, and I'll be in the same spot each time. Put my bait runner on, lay him down, and then well, here we go. Already.
Well, the surface activity seems to have slowed quite a bit there. They're just picking at it, but I've catapulted biscuits out. They're definitely taking the biscuits. And I thought I'd rig up and have a throw around, because I like floater fishing, basically. And what I've done is side hook a pop-up there. It's the only way I could think of doing it. And got a support there. Was a, you know, like a hair rig in reverse, if you like, to tie it to the shank. But I like to have the hooks buried normally. And there is a piece of unknown, disgusting floater bait that must be 30 years old. We used to call it floater bait. It will slide up and down the line, but all you do, just so you know, put, just pinch a little tiny shot there, and then when you cast, that stops that sliding down, so it's like another piece of float. I have had them actually take the floater bait as well. Not today. So it's going to be back to the feeder, I think, and this one can be changed. I might change the flavour on the pop-up I've got there, have another cast out, and I think I'll stick with the pellets because I still see really fine bubbles popping up every now and then, so I figure they're going to be on them.
Right, I'm on again, Graham. I think this change to the Ronnie rig with a little pink fruity pop-up has done the business here.
That was, what, 15 minutes later, wasn't it?
Yeah, literally. Casting right to the lily pads again, and I think the pop-up's just working a bit better. I think, obviously, with that drop in temperature, how it's been, I just think, obviously, changing your tactics can always result in fish. I've been fishing the PVA bags all day, nothing. There's a good bit of bait out there, and I changed one rod to a nice little pop-up on a Ronnie rig, and this rod's gone off twice now with the Ronnie rig on, so I was halfway through putting it on my other rod, and bang, it went off again.
You don't need two rods with that rig on there.
No.
You need one at the moment. Fish is down. There's another, is that a common again?
Yeah.
He is indeed. Hold the net for you again.
Yeah.
That's almost a twin of the first, or a tad bigger. Yeah. Yeah, looks a bit.
Might be, yeah.
I'll let you hold him up because I can't do it with my microphone.
That's okay.
Have you got the line in there somewhere? See if the line on the. Or is it just around the edge?
Got me drag off anyway, so. Oh, he seems a bit bigger, I think. This wind's coming in now, sort of easterly.
And they're giving that for next week, aren't they?
Yeah, so it could all change next week. There could be hardly any carp. It could be a really bad week with the cold weather and that coming in. But as you can see, a nice wally's coming again. Beautiful looking fish. I'm just about to put my second rod out again with the Ronnie rig on. So I'm going to have two out there now with this on. And hopefully... yeah, get a couple more. So these are coming within 15 minutes of each other.
Yeah, they're on the feed because that last
bait that went out
is about three or four zoomed off,
yeah,
didn't they?
Yeah, so I reckon he's about the same size as the last one, really, about 12, 13.
Yeah, he might squeak 13.
He feels a little bit bigger, I don't know, but
yeah.
It's hard to tell with these fish sometimes with a carp. A good thing to remember is like today, we'll sort of fish in. It's getting towards that winter period now, and the ground's quite silty where I'm fishing, and a lot of the trees and that are losing their leaves, so you will get a lot of sort of chod along the bottom. I was using the solid bags and they just weren't really working. So I changed over to a couple of Ronnie rigs, or people might know them as spinner rigs, with a small bit of stiff mono or fluorocarbon, whatever you choose, and a single bright pink pop-up. Because you got to remember as well, when it comes to winter time, the carp are not always going to be on the feed. They won't be grubbing around as much like they do in the summertime. So sometimes it's worth a little bit of bait out, not too much, but your single bright hook bait can be a lot more attractive in the winter than it probably would be in the summertime, when they're sort of grubbing around on all these sort of like the krill fish meal boilies. When they're on the feed, it does pay to have a bottom bait or a wafter, which is like the critically balanced bait I was talking about earlier. And just switching to that bright hook bait, casting it out in the same sort of spots. Obviously it was a pop-up, so it's suspended about 2 inch off the bottom, not very far. A bit of tungsten putty around on the line just before the hook, so it don't fully pop up in the water.
Oh, he's bigger. Definitely so. Get in. I'd say he's bigger, Mackie, that one. For sure. Absolutely for sure.
There we go. And another. That one's a bit bigger, I think. Like scallop-like tails. Absolute power in that.
Just like you were giving it CPR, eh?
Well, if you cover their eyes...
Yeah, calms them, doesn't it?
Calms
yeah.
them down. Absolute gorgeous common here. Brute, he's probably best part of 14.
14, I'd say he would be, yeah.
Not far off 15, I don't think. But, yeah, he's a gorgeous fish. So, yeah.
Result, as they say.
Result. So this fish had had another
recently, small
hook, and that's why you don't use light line when carp fishing.
It's like match tackle, wouldn't it?
Yeah, the line is literally, I can just, yeah, it's such a weak bit of line, probably about 4 pound, but yeah, that's
a maggot on the hook.
That's not what you want to use for these big boys.
No.
Good strong tackle, good strong hook. Results in a lovely lean looking fish, really nice mouth as well. It's nice barbs, that's what it uses to grub around with.